My heart is broken, it won't ever mend. I ain't much caring just where I will end. I must have that man.
Billie Holiday in I Must Have That Man. Probably one of the most tortured but talented female artists of all time. Hi everyone, this is NC Fro is Reading. I am your host, Felicia Baxter. Well, I'm going to start this podcast with several thoughts of the day. The first thought is tequila is of the devil. Enough said. The second thought of the day has to do with R. Kelly. Now, I'm not sure about how many people were aware of the charges back in the 90s, early 2000s, where it was alleged that R. Kelly was a pedophile and he was having sex with underage girls. Underage girls and was holding kids or women captive. He actually, and it's not clear if he was at one time married to the teenager Aaliyah for a very short period of time, and then she ends up, somehow, I don't know if it got annulled, but she may have then gone on to, she went on to stardom, but she ended up dying in a plane crash before she was 25 years old, which that whole situation was really sad. We had suspected that he was a pedophile during that time, but then tape leaked when he actually was taped urinating on a girl that was alleged to be about 13 or 14 years old. But he was cleared of all of those charges. Then recently, a Lifetime special called Surviving R. Kelly was released this year, and we got another glimpse into the pathology that was him. Not too long after that, another fresh case was opened in Chicago, where 8 women have come forward alleging sexual assault and misconduct, and he got locked up for that. Couldn't bail himself out, but I don't know if he was released on his own recognizance. Then he had this 2-part interview with ABC that was released, and we see him losing it on air, and he gets locked up again for a failure to pay $160,000 worth of child support. This guy was probably one of the most prolific songwriters and entertainers over the past 30 years, and now he says he has a Bank of America account that's on zero. Well, I've been there, but no, I don't have 3 Grammys, and no, I have not produced some of the most memorable hits of all time, but R. Robert, as Gil was calling him, what is going on? Why didn't you know that you have no money? Why can't you believe that nobody wants to work with you now? You are an alleged serial pedophile, and you are not taking any ownership of any of that. You allow all of these people, these hangers-on, and these people to bleed you dry for all of these years, and you have nothing to show for it. Hello? R. Kelly and all of the nonsense that's going on right now in the news. I think what is getting people is his lack of remorse. Of his wrongdoing, it is obvious there is a pattern of behavior that's not concerning, that is overall crazy. You know, you can't expect to mistreat and downright abuse women or anyone for that matter and get away with it. His time of reckoning is now. And it just makes his fall that more poignant, that you are not above the law and you're not above, well, actually, it seems like the law is maybe a little bit more forgiving than public opinion, because did he think that the music and his fame was going to protect him from public opinion and from the industry, that the industry was going to come to his assistance to allow him and propagate this pathology. He's made a lot of missteps and made a lot of misjudgments, I guess. And I get that he was probably severely abused as a child, never got help from it. He obviously poured out his brokenness and his pain in his music, but he never healed. He never healed from the cause of the pain. And how can he expect? The industry played on that. They played on the art. And as long as they were giving him art and his background and his life didn't bleed into his business and into that, bleed into the facade, he was fine. Everything was great. But when his art started to suffer and his art was, I guess you could say, corroded by the nastiness of his life, then of course those two things can't exist. How can he, and the industry and the public opinion is going to turn sour in that manner, and you're not safe. And then to beat the band, you're broke too. It's no different than the billionaire pedophile that abused and kept his kids in lockdown for a number of years. And those children, although there's some beautiful men and women, or man and woman, but they were severely abused. The flip side of that is they have gigobs of money to get the help that they need in order to heal. However, but the problem is, and it didn't help, it just seems like she is a captive. One of the young women that has been supposedly held captive for the last 2 years, she was interviewed after the R. Kelly interview, and she sounded just as crazy as he did. And I don't think neither one of them in the interview, I don't think the interview helped them at all. It just confirmed even more of what we knew of the pathology that surrounds this artist. And it's actually really sad, because I don't think now that no one is listening to him and no one is willing to record his music and he's broke as a joke, I think the world will not be entertained by him anymore. He may have some great music or some other to be able to present and to produce for the world, but the way he went about it, and whom he uses his muse, and it's all shaded. Nobody wants to listen to someone that is truly that diabolical. And what it kills me is he does not see his abuse of power. He does not see how he has jacked up all of these women's lives, including his ex-wife, including his own children, how they're all going to be affected by his pathology. I don't think he has the insurance, or he may not be able to pay for it, but he really needs help psychologically, mentally, whatever. But R. Kelly as the artist is no longer. I don't think he's going to come back from that. And unfortunately, black folks will support you to a certain extent, but he actually, I think he's done. Right now, he needs to figure out now how he's going to be able to make reparations to all of these women he hurt, as well as to his wife and his kids, because that's going to be a lifelong struggle. He needs to get his kids respect and make sure that they are taken care of, because this is not fair to them. So what else is going on? If you have not realized, and I apologize that the noise canceling quality of the earphones can't cancel out the noises of the wind outside of my car, but I'm actually on I-75 headed to Ashland, Kentucky, as we speak. I have some hours to put in at a facility that I am assigned to. Today is actually a really good day for a drive, because for once it's not raining, it's not foggy. It still is in the deep of winter, and I can't wait to come through this same pass in the spring. Come springtime, this part of the country, I'm going to go on record as saying, is probably some of the most beautiful in the Southeast. Yes, Florida has its mystiques, and South Carolina, North Carolina, even Virginia, all along the coastline of the Southeast is the bomb, but there's just something about being in the mountains in the spring. All of the flowers, all the green trees, rolling hills, grass, it is just a sight to see. I'm excited about being able to visit waterfalls. Unlike Oregon, which has about 200 different waterfalls, there's waterfalls all through the Appalachian Mountains. My intent in the next several months is not only to go to some of the oyster and seafood festivals on the Outer Banks, but I intend to enjoy as much of the mountains of Appalachia as I possibly can. I think my stint in Oregon, although it gave me PTSD from the rain, it's allowed me to develop a greater appreciation for the Southeast, and there's just so much I want to see and to do here. This weekend, my also is intent is to pay a visit to McKay's used books, I think, in Music Cellar. I wonder if how much old vinyl they actually have in that store. I haven't been in a number of years, but that's actually one of my stops on my way back to Tennessee. I'm also planning on visiting Sweetwater Farm, and I think there's a winery there. But for most people that don't know, I'm thinking it's the same Sweetwater that is the one of the small microbreweries in the area. So maybe I'll be able to pay a visit to that or them also. And there's a number of different wineries all along that 75 corridor, believe it or not, in Tennessee. Yes, Tennessee, Kentucky, are on the Bourbon Trail, but there's several family-run wineries that populate this area, too, that I'm excited about visiting. Sunday, I'm actually going to be doing a little bit, putting a couple of hours in at work. It's not really extra. It's just because I will not be on site my usual Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. So I want to make up some hours if it's possible or needed on Sunday. But I still plan on doing my usual whole foods. Does serve breakfast, a really amazing breakfast on Sundays. And now I know that Walgreens in north side of Chattanooga also carries the Sunday New York Times as well as the weekend version of the Wall Street Journal. And I plan on doing all of that, hanging out before I actually have to go to work for about 4 or 5 hours. You can always do a lot of work no matter if you have bacon in your belly. Just saying. So my weekends I'm hopeful that it's going to be really relaxed and I will have the opportunity to enjoy it and get a really good sleep. I'm actually very thankful where I am, even though, again, I still despise going to Ashland, Kentucky. But the ride there is actually really cool. It's just the actual place kind of sucks. But anyways, so what am I going to be talking about in the next several minutes? I had the opportunity to read another one or read a selection by Terry McMillan of Waiting to Exhale fame and How Stella Got Her Groove Back fame. But she's also a very prolific writer, and she's written several short stories. And the one that I actually read, which is one of the last short stories in Calling the Wind book, she wrote this in 1991. It's called Quilting on the Rebound, and it is so quintessential Terry McMillan. It's about a woman that is working for an insurance bank. Her name is Marilyn. And she, at 38, she becomes engaged to a guy. And they had been dating for a number of years. Right before they get married, she actually discovers that she's pregnant. She's overjoyed. Not too much. And then right before the wedding, about 2 weeks prior to the wedding, I don't know what she was actually doing in the mall, but she actually miscarries in the mall. And then about a week or two prior to them, and she didn't tell anyone. She doesn't tell him about the miscarriage until after he calls off the engagement, because that's what actually freaks her out. She is so overwrought, not so much, and Terry McMillan writes this, she wasn't so angry with the fact that he called off the engagement. She was more pissed off hurt that she had lost her baby, because she knew at 38, 37, 38, that may have been one of the last times that she was going to be able to get pregnant. Because she was at an advanced maternal age. But she took some time off of work, and she actually learned to sew, from her mother. And she started sewing as a break from what was her life. And she started with a whole bunch of quilts, et cetera, et cetera, and combinations and patterns that she really could not dream that they would actually come together, but they actually came together and was beautiful in celebration of her African-American as well as her Japanese heritage. instead of going back to the same insurance company or her usual job and having to confront everyone there as well as her ex-fiancé, she requests and is granted a transfer to Phoenix. Now, this is where I actually, it was kind of funny because I've read all of Terry McMillan's, if you've read or saw the movie from Waiting to Exhale to How Stella Got Her Groove Back, she basically utilized Phoenix as well as, or Scottsdale in this instance, as well as some of the characters from those previous books. Gloria, Marilyn, I don't think Marilyn was actually in the book. I remember Whitney Houston's character, but I don't think her name was Marilyn. And then Angela Bassett's character was Bernadine. So Marilyn, not so much. But anyways, she goes back after she's recuperating from the miscarriage and the dissolution of her engagement, but when she visits Gloria, and she loves Scottsdale so much that that's why she goes and requests the request and is granted the transfer to Phoenix. Then after that, she gets there and she realizes that she absolutely hates it. She takes a pay cut as well as a smaller office, and as far as insurance anyway, Phoenix is not the mecca that LA was. However, her quilting is what saves her again. She basically is given so many orders just on word of mouth spread by her friend Gloria, and through the assistance of Gloria and Bernadine and a lawyer, she is able to open up a craft shop in the same shopping center that Gloria's beauty shop is. And it's just amazing how she basically builds her life through sewing. She puts the pieces of her life back together just as she puts the pieces together to build those quilts. And she keeps it moving. She even sends one of her handcrafted quilts to her ex-fiancé in celebration of his marriage. Because again, she never was sad that they didn't get married. She was just annoyed of his weaselly way of backing out of it. And also, she was still mourning the death of her unborn child. I thought it was actually well written, and you could see the beginning of the quintessential Terry McMillan style in the writing. Irreverence and how women, even in spite of being alone, they continue to grow. I want to read for you, if I can, a small snippet from that last section of the book itself.
And this time I wanted to make sure that I have the microphone is on and I also am recording. I actually went through an entire episode and realized that I didn't have my QuickTime recording the session itself. I guess this is going to give me the opportunity to restate some things that I wish I had said better the first time. So it's all not a loss. It's just that a lot of time has been, I haven't had a good use of my time or the time, and I'm just going to have to publish this a little bit later. But I'm actually going to read for you the last several paragraphs of Terry McMillan's Quilting on the Rebound. I've been living here a year when I found out that Richard had married another woman who worked in our office. I wanted to hate him, but I didn't. I wanted to be angry, but I wasn't. I didn't feel anything towards him, but I sent him a quilt and a wedding card to congratulate him just because. To be honest, I've been so busy with my shop, I haven't even thought about men. I don't even miss having sex unless I really just think about it. My libido must be evaporating because when I do think about it, I just make quilts or jewelry or paint t-shirts and the feeling goes away. Some of my best ideas come at these moments. Basically, I'm doing everything I can to make Marilyn feel good. And at 39 years old, my body needs tightening, so I joined a health club and started working out 3 to 4 times a week. Once in a while, I babysit for Bernadine, and it breaks my heart when I think about the fact that I don't have a child of my own. Sometimes Gloria and I go out to hear some music. I frequent most of the major art galleries, go to just about every football game and basketball game at Arizona State, and see at least one movie a week. She sounds like, or I sound like her. I'm rarely bored, which is why I've decided that at this point in my life, I really don't care if I ever get married. I've learned that I don't need a man in order to survive, that a man is nothing but an intrusion, and they require too much energy. I don't think they're worth it. Besides, they have too much power, and from what I've seen, they always seem to abuse it. The one thing I do have is power over my own life, and I like it this way, and I'm not about to give that up for something that may not last. The one thing I do want is to have a baby, someone I could love who could or would love me back with no strings attached. But at 39, I know my days are numbered. I'd be willing to do it alone if that's the only way I can have one. But right now, my life is almost full. It's fun, it's secure, and it's safe. About the only thing I'm concerned about these days is whether or not it's time to branch out into leather. That is the quintessential part of Terry McMillan that I was referring to earlier. And it seems like she's kind of back and forth on having a child in so late in life. It does appear that her life is full of things to do and her friends, etc. She would like the conventionalness of having a child, but it's not a make or break situation, it doesn't sound like. And if you compare this character, the Marilyn character, to Terry McMillan's life, it was when how Stella got her groove back, when she is basically writing from a place of happiness, when she actually meets and marries her Winston Shakespeare. The issue was he then comes out and as homosexual after he immigrates to America. And her next work reflected, and you could feel the pain within the pages themselves. And she is right. This book, this particular work, and all the works that I've talked about this week all seem to me to be a part of the whole Me Too movement is about recognizing women and their suffering and the abuse and how it's not cool and how resilient women have always been because we've had to be. How we deal with pain, how we deal with abuse, how we deal with loneliness, how we deal with the changing times and the unacceptability of it all between Harvey Weinstein, Bill Cosby, those other jokers, you know, from the hip hop as well as from the pop world, and also R. Kelly now, how all of those people, and let's not forget Michael Jackson, how all of those people abused their power, how women, children, and anybody underneath them are subject to that, but how they also rose to the occasion and succeeded. This is a story for the times that we're living in now, how women have had to, by force almost, reinvent themselves, and how something that she really liked to do that helped her build and put her life together quilting actually became her livelihood, and she could still enjoy just creating those things when she was in pain. And I think that is what kind of blew me away, and I thought it touched me in a different place. This character's entire story. But we go from brokenness into creativity, and just how this character, Billie Holiday, she responded to that. Billie Holiday's life was not that of easy. And I remember, and I always, even up until I started researching it and got this program together, you always heard about this lady with this voice, and how she basically sang and felt every single word that she would ever sing. However, and I'm used to the picture of the troubled female with the face that looked like it had been punched or hit with a bag of nickels. However, she wasn't always like that. From the time that she was 18 until she passed away at 44, you could see the transition from this beautiful, beautiful African-American woman to this tragic figure that was ravaged by alcohol and heroin. I see a picture now, or I'm looking at her photo now of her. I don't even recognize this lady. And she had her quintessential big white magnolia in her head, and that was her her signature. But the face of this woman, she was just so beautiful, but it belied the trouble that she actually was living through. If I had to bet, I would bet that Miss Billie Holiday was actually bipolar, untreated, and she was self-medicating to escape the demons that followed her everywhere, from the brothels of Maryland to the abusive and the fist of her husband. I think that's why she used, even against doctor's orders, they told her, stop drinking, stop drugging, you'll live. And she couldn't stop because the demons were just too powerful for her. But before she died, she did just bless the world with her song and her voice. And I bring to you one of her earlier recordings. It's probably one of my favorite Billie Holiday recordings. It's called The Way You Look Tonight. This is Billie Holiday. Again, that's Billie Holiday, The Way You Look Tonight. Again, that's one of her most notable and just a great song. And I am just tickled pink that I actually got to share that with you. So in my zeal of reading several selections and making sure to have those Billie Holiday songs that would most fit with what I'm reading in the overall tone of the recording or of this episode, I read several artists and I picked out those artists and thinking that names like Jean and Jessie were obviously female. I don't know how I overlooked Jean Toomer, because dude is a dude, not a female. But I find it striking that this guy, what was his attempt or what was his premise of writing about a little girl who actually grew into a young woman? He was an older gentleman by the time he passed away, but what was the drive? And I think maybe because he was raised by women or a woman, he may have had a more unique perspective in writing this particular character. Mr. Toomer himself was born in 1894 in D.C., and he passed away in 1967. He was raised by his mother, as I said before, in his grandparents' home in Georgetown. It sounds like he was from a relatively affluent family, but there's no mention of his father. As a young man, he enrolled and dropped out of several universities. In search for a philosophy to live by, he eventually became a Quaker. He wrote Cain in 1923, and that is his best-known work, a collection of his previously unpublished writings, The Wayward and The Seeking, appeared again in 1980. I find that this has been a reoccurring theme with a lot of these authors in this book, especially from the early 20th century. They were forgotten, but in their own right, especially during the Harlem Renaissance that Billie Holiday was active, a lot of these people were published and well-known during that particular time and then was rediscovered by another generation. What I was also struck with about that all of these people were highly educated in a time where lynchings were the norm. This gentleman in 1923 wrote of a character by the name of Esther. From the time she was 9 years old until she became an adult at the age of 27. And I will spare the reading of any selections within the books because one is in dialect, but I think the true meaning from it, I think I now understand more so than I did before that she or this character became so focused on a guy named Barlow, who was a prophet or in his own right. And it sounds like she was also very fair complected, and actually she looked like a little white child. And even so, her father actually had a grocery store well run on the boulevard. She could have had her pick of any guy in town, but she became focused on this base guy, the blackest dude in town. And it seems like as self-hatred, her own self-hatred was portrayed in her focus on this bottom Negro. I think this is also testament of a time of about how color, and it still does, but shape the American psyche. And it could also become a source of hate, self-hatred, and self-loathing that I don't think the African-American community has recovered from. Because even though she was a percentage, even though she looked white, she had a drop of Negro blood in her, and that made her a Negro. And I can't imagine a female trying to navigate in that world, and also that she also had a mental illness. I can't imagine how difficult it was for her to navigate in that world, because she never would have known her worth. And it sounds like she flipped out at the end anyways, where the world melted away because the object of her obsession even rejected her. It seems like she could not love herself. Therefore, the person that she became obsessed with couldn't love her. And she basically became nothing. And unfortunately, unlike the other characters, she actually succumbed to her pathology, it seems like, because of the danglingness of the end of this story. And granted, this is probably not one of the most interesting stories I've read in this selection of short stories, but it just made for kind of good reading. I was just struck by the author himself, as well as the times that he was writing in. And I think he did a very good job of writing about the teenage and female angst, even though he is obviously not a female. But it does bring us to a time, and I've been remarking about this, it does bring to us to a poignant time, because this is also when Billie Holiday herself was born. I want to read you a little bit about her background and her life. This is a lot of stuff that I had no idea, because at the time of this, I just realized that at the time that book was written, Billie Holiday was about 9 years old. She was actually born April 7th in 1915 in Pennsylvania. She rose to prominence during the 30s with a unique style that reinvented the conventions of modern singing and performance. More than 80 years after making her first recording, Billie's legacy continues to embody what is elegant and cool in contemporary music. She was born Eleonora Fagan Gow, grew up in jazz-soaked Baltimore in the 20s. In her early teens, the beginning part of her apprenticeship, she was spent singing along with records of iconoclasts like Betsy Smith and Louis Armstrong. In 1929, Billie's mother, Sadie Fagan, moved to New York in search of better jobs. Young Eleonora soon joined her there and began showing up at jazz clubs to audition and sing for the resident pianist. She made debuts in obscure Harlem nightclubs, sharing tips with other dancers and comedians on the bill. Around this time, she borrowed her professional name, Billie Holiday, from screen actress Billie Dove. Although she never received technical training and never learned how to read music, Holiday quickly became an active participant in what was then the most vibrant jazz scene in the country as the Harlem Renaissance transitioned into the swing era. She would go on to work with probably some of my most favorite musicians like Count Basie and her favorite Louis Armstrong and even Benny Goodman. Her talent was extraordinary. But it was also during this time she basically recorded the poem of an unknown socialist high school teacher who was affected by pictures and writings of lynchings in the South. He actually wrote a poem that where she basically they produced the song that she is with, that's quintessential Billie Holiday, called Strange Fruit. And I'll read from you from the website. In the 1930s, during her epic run at Barney Joseph's Cafe Society in Manhattan, she was introduced to the poem Strange Fruit. a horrific depiction of lynching in the southern United States. The music was written just for Billie, and it became the hallmark of her concerts. It's considered by scholars to be the first protest song of the civil rights era, but it was written as a poem in the 1930s, and she recorded it in the 40s. The lyric was so controversial that her record label wouldn't record it, so she jumped over to the independent Commodore Records, where she could record and sing as she pleased. Strange Fruit, written by that high school teacher, Abel Mirapole, became an immediate cultural spark point and hit record, too. Some of the lyrics... even though it never mentioned lynching, it alludes to it in such a poignant way. Southern trees bear strange fruit, blood on leaves and blood at the root. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. And it goes on, and it's just a very horrific scene, worse than the crucifixion. And I actually wanted to play a little bit of that for you tonight. This is Strange Fruit, recorded by Billie Holiday, 1939.
Southern trees bear a strange fruit, blood on the leaves and blood at the root. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze, strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
As I said, that amazing, and I can also see it's such a departure from her other songs, but just as poignant. And as early as 1939, that was a pretty, although indirect, it was a pretty dangerous statement to cast judgment to a uniquely Southern institution of hanging them high for absolutely no reason except for being an African American. She didn't escape to France as Josephine Baker did, which in itself, in a lot of Josephine Baker's feats, being a spy and performing and living over in France as African American, and then finally coming back to the States a number of years later, I thought what she did was brave, but staying in the thick of it here in this country was also brave. And recording and releasing that song was extremely brave during a very turbulent point of our history, and I'm glad she did. My next selection is right around the time that Billie Holiday was recording, and you could also say on her last leg in 1958. This author or writer by the name of Ann Petry was actually born in 1908 in Connecticut, where she lived most of her life. Her father was a local druggist, and she herself worked as a pharmacist after earning a PhD in 1931, which struck me because, again, it was the freaking 30s, and she was an African-American woman getting a higher education. Again, I thought it was just amazing. But she also lived briefly in New York and did postgraduate work at Columbia while working in advertising and as a reporter during the early 40s. Author of The Street in 1946 and two other novels, Petry has published four children's books and a short story collection, Miss Muriel and Other Stories, in 1953. She, in the selection that I'm going to be referring to next, is Has Anybody Seen Miss Dora Dean by Anne Petry, 1958. The main character, that actually is a song, evidently, that was a part of the vaudeville scene, and it was the main song that the main character, Sarah Forbes, her husband used to whistle while he was the butler to a rich white family that used to summer in Wheeler, Connecticut. Sarah Forbes herself was utterly charming, but she was also very annoying at the same time. She had been a beautiful, beautiful, tall and thin woman who had grown immensely fat, and it looked like she was very top heavy, but she had small legs and a very caustic sense of humor. She could be charming when she wanted to be, but she could be caustic otherwise. Her husband, John Forbes, was the exact opposite, so it was very compelling that he would be whistling a vaudeville song. He had worked for most of his adult life as the butler for this wealthy family, and also was the butler right up until the wife died later on in life. He met and married Sarah when he was in his 40s and she was 20. They lived up until his death of suicide in the house that he inherited from the rich white family. His suicide caused a lot of consternation within the black community because they couldn't understand why he would kill himself. They kept wondering, and the author wrote, they sounded as though he said to them, "This life all of us black folks lead is valueless. It is disgusting, it is cheap, it is contemptible, and I'm throwing it away so that everyone will know exactly what I think of it." This is another character with a lot of self-loathing to the fact that he wanted to end his life. But again, the women that were around him went on. At the time that he ended his life, he had left what could have potentially been a financial disaster with Sarah, and she also had a son by that time. He had used most of his inheritance to buy six rental houses, which Sarah basically kept, with her needling, wheedling ways, kept from foreclosure through the Depression, to the point where the white bankers actually congratulated her because she was able to do with a lot of white men and definitely no black man could do by holding on to her property intact. She would eventually sell those properties for a profit, and she would only keep the house that was bequeathed to them. Again, amazing, amazing story. And it sounds like the house was chock-a-block with oversized furniture and a lot of china, because the narrator, who I'm assuming was Miss Petry, was ordered to come up to where Sarah was, and on her deathbed, she bequeathed the narrator what I believe was savory chocolate pot in like in a coffee set, a tea set, I believe. She wanted her to have it because she knew as a woman that she would know what to do with it versus her sons that would not know what to do with it and would probably toss it because they would see no value in it. But she bequeathed this and she basically waited until she could come to give this to someone, knowing that it would set her at peace, knowing that it would go to someone that would know its value, even in spite of her own children and her grandchild, because she knew those boneheads would not understand what to do with a porcelain Sevres coffee set that could be owned by French royalty and what that would mean. And it seemed to be an honor to bequeath such something of that magnitude that held such a grand place in this dying woman's heart. Again, this story also showed the resilience of this the women of the time and how Sarah herself and even the narrator could be subject to power and how power can corrupt. But this woman was able to eke out a living. She had changed, her external body had changed and had then probably been ravaged by, who knows, cancer or poorly controlled diabetes or congestive heart failure for all we know. Even in spite of being at the end of her life, she still held on to her wits to know what was actually important. And she actually had to have the balls to be able to do it in spite, because they had written that her husband was a little bit effeminate, but and died when the focus of his life, which was his job, ended with at the time that that last woman actually had died. I don't know if he was tussling for his latent homosexuality. I don't know if he was going down to the bottoms, had sunk so low that he was looking for a thrill down in the bottoms. That's where he actually laid across the railroad track. But he couldn't face whatever he was facing, so he actually killed himself. But that was never an option for Sarah and for the women of that time. She had to carry on. And she wasn't going to apologize for it either. And everyone did her bidding, her sons, and even her grandson. Billie Holiday said something that I thought was very poignant in her life. And she had many sayings, but she said, "I never hurt nobody but myself, and that's nobody's business but my own." I wish Jesse Smollett and R. Kelly and Bill Cosby could actually say the same thing. No, they can't. They did a lot of hurt in order to for their own pleasure. Nothing like Lady Day at all. But anyways, my next selection is from 1956, "Tain't Nobody's Business," Billie Holiday. I hope you enjoy this selection.
Criticize me, but I'm going to do just as I want to anyway, and don't care just what people say. fashion, take a notion to jump into the ocean. Ain't nobody's business if I do. If I go to church on Sunday, then cabaret all day Monday. Ain't nobody's business if I do.
I hope you enjoyed that. Ain't nobody's business. I think that should be on the soundtrack of our lives. If we're not hurting anybody and we're all, but the flip side of that is if we are being productive, we should, who cares? No, that doesn't account for bad behaviors and being mean to people. No. And no, I don't condone heavy drinking, abusive drinking, or abusing of narcotics. I think you should get the help if you're actually having some psychological pain. Get the help for it and find some other outlet. I wish she were like the Marilyn character and just continued to record and she didn't shoot up, because that means, you know, she would have lived so much longer. I wish she had poured herself into her music and not poured money into heroin. We would have been able to enjoy her for a number of more years, but that's me being selfish. My last selection is from Jessie Fauset. Jessie Fauset was born in 1882 in New Jersey, and she grew up near Philadelphia and was educated at the University of Pennsylvania, Cornell, and the Sorbonne. She's the author of four novels, There Is Confusion, Pum Bun, The China Tree, and Comedy American Style. All of these dates, 1924, 1928, 1931, 1933, is at the peak of the Harlem Renaissance. Her books were forgotten after they were published, of course, because she was a female and African-American, and weren't rediscovered into the resurgence of interest in African-American writers in the 70s. But again, I find it just telling that she was educated and highly educated and published during a time, again, when we were being lynched, when we were being burned, when we were just killed for absolutely no reason except for being black. I find that just amazing, her success in her lifetime. She writes Mary Elizabeth in 1919, and this is basically a short book or a short writing about a character by the name of Sally, who's married and who's a housewife, and she's actually married to what appears to be a dismissive man by the name of Roger. They are obviously African American, living in the African American part of town. Sally doesn't do mornings. She hates coffee, so she doesn't know how to make it, and she makes rubbery pancakes. Roger demands that she makes him breakfast and then complains about the breakfast, even though he knows that she don't know how to cook breakfast. She does better with lunch and can go to delicatessen to pick up sandwiches. But other than that, you know, they seem to be well-to-do because they support a ne'er-do-well maid that they seem to keep around for the entertainment purposes. Mary Elizabeth seems to be on par with Florence Jefferson and is kept around simply for the entertainment factor and not necessarily for her culinary or her ability to keep house. She tells stories about her travails with her first and second husband. And even when Sally goes to fact check, the yarns that she seems to be spinning are actually based in truth. Even in spite of her hardship, she still manages to find her place and her way in the world. Anybody that shows up 3 hours late to start of their shift would ordinarily get fired. But again, I think Sally keeps her around for her entertainment value because her husband is such a douche. That story itself was basically entertaining too, just because how you can see the differences between two different generations and how they work together and how they can actually support themselves, and in itself becomes an entertaining tale within a tale. It's crazy that I think at one point Mary Elizabeth says she's telling a story about the lady that keeps her house. And I'm thinking to myself, how aren't you a maid and you have a maid? That is the craziest thing I've ever heard. And again, they fact checked and she actually has a maid. Everyone that she basically has told a story about actually has existed and in those circumstances. So that actually in itself is entertaining. And what's even more poignant, it was written in 1919. Everyone that I've actually spoken about, from Billie Holiday to the teacher Abel Meeropol, and to all of the great writers that expand this last century, have a special place in my heart. And I hope by me presenting them in this manner, you also will have a special place in your heart. And I can also feel great that I've actually hit the record button so I can actually share this with the world. But anyways, I'm getting ready to sign off. This has been an actually enjoyable production for me. And I hope that I have been able to share with you some very interesting selections that will pique your interest to not only read these selections, but also to read other selections and go where you would not have necessarily have known to go. I hope that you would do even more research into these authors and Billie Holiday and a lot of the other artists from the Harlem Renaissance and from the swing era. I think there's so many other stories and things to be taught and known from that era, and I hope that you will find it in your heart and in your heart, but also that you will discover a part and something that makes you feel good and that is entertaining at the same time. I hope that my sharing with you these authors and this music, it will cause you not to forget and to have a greater appreciation for women and our contribution to history and our contribution to culture and our country. This is NC Fro signing off. I leave you with But Beautiful, Billie Holiday, 1958.
Love is funny, oh, it's sad, it's quiet, oh, it's mad, it's a good thing, oh, it's bad, but beautiful. Beautiful to take a chance, and if you fall, you fall, and I'm thinking I wouldn't mind at all. Love is let's game. It's a problem.